Welcome, everyone. My name's Patricia Davidson, and I have the honour and privilege of being the Dean of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. Today, I would like to pay my respects to the traditional owners of the land. The Johns Hopkins School of Nursing respectfully acknowledges and gives thanks to the Piscataway tribe, the Indigenous people who are the traditional owners of the lands of the Chesapeake Bay region. We also acknowledge all Indigenous peoples, the traditional owners of the lands and waters of the United States of America. It's my great pleasure today to welcome you to a special event in our school, the Isabel Hampton Robb Lecture Series. This lectureship is given by a stellar nurse scientist on our faculty. And so today, as well as welcoming all of the faculty, staff and students, I'd also like to welcome any members and friends of the Reynolds and Alonzo family that may have joined us here today. And I'm sorry that we cannot be here all together in person. And just before I introduce Dr. Nancy Reynolds, I wanted to share a little bit about Isabel Hampton Robb and why this lectureship is so special. In 1889, Isabel Hampton Robb became the first superintendent of nurses at the Johns Hopkins Hospital and was also principal of the nursing school. She was an exceptional scholar and visionary who laid the foundations for our reputation as a school. She advocated for nurses learning languages and the sciences, and for nurses being not just kind, but smart. As a prolific author, she wrote the first textbook on nursing ethics and used her voice to be a true pioneer for charting the future of nursing. She wanted all nurses to be educated, and her legacy has transformed not just here at Johns Hopkins, but around the world. So this lectureship honors her legacy and brings forth scholars today who mirror that same passion for nursing excellence and innovation. So now it is my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Nancy Reynolds, our Associate Dean for Global Affairs, Director of the Center for Global Initiatives, and Co-Director of the WHO Collaborating Center for Nursing Information Knowledge Management. Dr. Reynolds was also instrumental in developing the first State of the World's Nursing Report, launched in April this year by the World Health Organization. Dr. Reynolds is a researcher in the field of chronic illness self-management with more than 20 years of continuous funding from the National Institutes of Health. Her research has focused on the development of interventions that use low-cost cell phone technology to bring healthcare services to vulnerable populations, particularly those affected by HIV. She has implemented programs to improve medication adherence and mental health outcomes of women and children living with HIV in Ghana, India, and the United States. Her accolades and tributes are many. She is a fellow of the American Heart of the American Academy of Nursing, a member of the Sigma Theta Tau International Nurse Researcher Hall of Fame, and she is Co-Secretary General of the Global Network of the WHO Collaborating Centres for Nursing and Midwifery. Dr. Reynolds is an invaluable asset to our school and our profession, and we are so delighted that she is on our faculty, part of our school, and is here to speak today to honour the memory of our founder, Isabel Hampton Robb. Please welcome our 2020 Isabel Hampton Robb Scholar, Dr. Nancy Reynolds.
Oh, thank you so much, Dean Davidson, and thank you to all of you who are joining today. I so appreciate it. It is such a privilege to be a part of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing community and to have had the opportunity to work under the amazing leadership of Dean Davidson and with the excellent faculty, students, staff, and alumni. I'm so impressed with the hard work, the values, the successes, and the constant striving to do better that are demonstrated on a daily basis here. And I'm so honored to have the opportunity to give the Isabel Hampton Robb lecture today. She was a highly influential leader, as Dean Davidson mentioned, and her work has had enduring impact. And she's played a large role in advancing the social status of nursing through her work developing a curriculum of more advanced training, which she developed during her time at Johns Hopkins. And unfortunately, her work is not finished, and there is much work to be done, as we have seen in the recently released State of the World's Nursing Report. So, 2020 is a highly significant year for nurses around the world. As Dean Davidson mentioned, first it was the release of the inaugural State of the World's Nursing 2020 report, released in April by the World Health Organization. And 2020 is the International Year of the Nurse and the Midwife. And I look at this picture, which I came across a couple of days ago, with some sadness. I was at the World Health Assembly on the day it was announced that 2020 would be the year of the nurse and midwife. And I look at the joy in this picture and the anticipation of the celebration of nursing and midwifery. But the year has not turned out quite as we had anticipated. Instead, we are seeing nurses on the front lines of the unprecedented COVID-19 pandemic. And as COVID-19 continues to spread globally, the important and unique role nurses play, nevertheless, is, you know, in keeping the world healthy, has really come into sharper focus. And yet, while we're really seeing what nurses are able to accomplish in their work with COVID-19 and on the front lines, we are also seeing that they are highly vulnerable. And as the World Health Organization said, you know, nurses are on the front line fighting COVID-19, but an alarming failure in the global supply of protective clothing and the new coronavirus tests, together with the unprecedented overwork linked to global staff shortages, have highlighted how truly vulnerable they are. The ICN confirms that 1,500 nurses have now died from COVID-19 in 44 different countries. And there are estimates that the healthcare worker fatalities worldwide could be more than 20,000. We are at a critical juncture for elevating the voice and influence of nursing right now toward better healthcare for all. And I think it's very valuable that we plan and do our work with an eye toward furthering the impact of what we do. You know, we are stronger working together, and perhaps most likely with much more of an intersectorial approach. But at the same time, I think we can see that one person and one voice can have enormous influence. And today, I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about my background in domestic and global settings and implications I'm seeing that are coming into focus for me in 2020, and hopefully have a little time for a discussion. So the mission of the Johns Hopkins University School of Nursing is to improve the health of individuals in diverse communities, locally and globally, through leadership and excellence in nursing education, research, practice, and service. This mission really resonates for me. I think in nursing for a long time, we have talked about the importance of each of these domains. But really in my career, I see that all of these are embedded in everything I do as a scientist. I'm thinking about the educational component, of the policy component and leadership component and the practice and how it's going to inform practice. In the broadest sense, my work is really focused on the intersection of healthcare quality, healthcare access, and health behavior, and how these impact health outcomes, but definitely considered within a social appreciation of the social structure and policy. And my career really began working very much at the individual level as a staff nurse, working with in critical care with heart patients, diabetic patients, and eventually patients living with HIV. And I really came to appreciate in the course of my work, as I started with a Bachelor of Science in Nursing and then did a Master's in Community Health, and then my PhD had a minor in Sociology and Public Health. And I really came to appreciate how our healthcare system is so focused on acute care management, and that patients living with chronic illnesses are often doing a lot of the management of their illness outside of healthcare settings, on their own, in home, and there are often big gaps. So a lot of my career has really focused on how we can strengthen that and access to care. Ms. Dean Davidson mentioned most of my work has been focused in the area of HIV. And really, I started caring for incredibly ill patients infected with HIV in the 80s who would come into the ICU and be just acutely ill. But we really saw a tremendous change in the management of HIV, which went from a very rapid downward trajectory after diagnosis prior to the mid-1990s to all of a sudden having effective antiretroviral therapy available and really seeing a turn in the tide where HIV became much more managed as a chronic illness. But what was so striking is what was originally an infection that was primarily in the US, it started to spread globally. And once we had identified effective therapies, it was very, the inequities in healthcare were striking. I always attend a meeting, the International AIDS Society meeting, which is a fascinating meeting. It collects scientists, policymakers, world leaders, people from NGOs, all coming together trying to grapple with the problem of HIV. And in the early 1990s, we're all sort of there grappling, what are we gonna do? How are we gonna solve this? But after the development of combination therapy, there was a huge divide at this meeting that was incredibly noticeable, where it was the countries that had access to antiretroviral therapies and the countries that didn't. And they were dealing with incredibly different problems then at that point. But through enormous efforts globally of many parties, we have seen very effective change. And now antiretroviral therapies are really quite effectively being available to most countries and people living with HIV. So we've seen great advances in the prevention and the treatment of HIV, which have dramatically reduced morbidity and mortality across the globe. The number of individuals who are newly infected with HIV has declined. And we're seeing greater numbers of individuals with HIV receiving treatment. But despite the incredible gains, globally, we still have 38 million people living with HIV as of 2019, up from 29.8 million in 2001. And we still had nearly 2 million people become newly infected with HIV last year. And we had nearly 700,000 people die of HIV. And we're continuing to see disparities that are linked to gender and geography, race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, and stigma, which has been ever present in the HIV pandemic. We're also continuing to see children infected with HIV and primarily in the South, especially in African countries. To achieve viral suppression and to promote personal and population health, an individual must be diagnosed with HIV. They have to know they have HIV, and we have many people who are still living with HIV who don't know it. They have to be linked to care, they have to remain in care, and they need to receive antiretroviral therapy, and they need to take it. They need to take it every day. But people living with HIV often face challenges in achieving adequate adherence to their medications. And this is really where much of my work has focused. As succinctly put in the oft-quoted words of C. Everett Koop, our former Surgeon General, drugs don't work in patients who don't take them. And poor adherence to treatment of chronic diseases is a worldwide problem, really of striking magnitude. And I was a part of a work group that was headed up by WHO in the early 2003. And we studied adherence across different illnesses and found that typically adherence rates of 80% or more are needed for optimal therapeutic efficacy. But it's really estimated that across chronic diseases that really medication adherence is only around 50%. So the impact of poor adherence grows as the burden of chronic disease grows worldwide. The vulnerable and the marginalized are disproportionately affected. The consequences of poor adherence to long-term therapies are poor health outcome and increased healthcare costs. And the point made in the report by WHO is that increasing the effectiveness of adherence interventions may have a far greater impact on the health of the population than any improvement in specific medical treatments. And I think this is a point that may be well taken once we have an effective vaccine for COVID. People are going to need to take the vaccine. Having just developing it isn't enough. But how do we get people to take therapeutics? The reasons people do not take medications prescribed are complex and multidimensional. And reasons for non-adherence vary by person. They are system levels, provider level factors, and individual level factors such as depression, stigma, forgetfulness. And this has been the big challenge in developing effective interventions to try to help improve adherence to medications, because oftentimes the interventions that are developed are too one-dimensional. They may, for example, just be focused on helping to remind people to take their medication, but that in fact may not be the problem at all. And I think about a patient I had in HIV who had a lot of gastrointestinal problems from his HIV medications when he was first started on them. And he started skipping medications. And his real issue wasn't that he was forgetting to take them. His issue was that he thought his coworkers going to see him running to the bathroom all the time, and this was going to out him as somebody who was ill. And yet too often our approach in healthcare settings is to tell patients, you know, you've been put on this medication, you need to take it, and then they send them off with their prescription. And as Victor Strechter at the University of Michigan, who does really beautiful work, he said, we've known for over 50 years that providing information alone to people does not change behavior. So this has become a big focus of my work. How can I develop an effective intervention? And when I first started doing my work in the area of HIV, we knew very little about adherence. And we didn't know why people weren't taking medications. We didn't even know how to measure adherence very effectively. But I had done a postdoc at the University of Rochester where I worked with Gene Johnson and really started to become very familiar with this self-regulatory framework developed by Leventhal and others. And I really used this to guide the development of the intervention that I have since tested. And within this sub-regulatory framework, individuals are thought to be motivated to regulate or minimize threats to their health and well-being and act in ways to reduce these threats in ways that are consistent with their perceptions of them. The individual interprets stimuli and acts to maintain or enhance an acceptable or desirable status or avert or reduce a stimulus that is interpreted as unacceptable to them or undesirable. And the stimulus can be psychological, physical, anticipatory, and fluctuate from moment to moment. An individual considers their options and selects an action based upon their perception of viable option and past successes and failures under similar circumstances. And once an action is taken, the individual praises the effectiveness of the action, the outcome appraisal and then makes modifications as considered necessary. They may feel, you know, I'm still feeling bad, I need to try something else, or they may feel that what they're doing is effective and they'll continue to do it. You know, and a variety of different factors set the stage for the self-regulating process and the influences of how a person interprets their illness and the stimuli and the perception of their viable options. And really at the most basic level, the individual's sense of self, who they are in relation to the world, develops through the individual's interaction with the social circumstances. And these obviously vary by culture and socioeconomic environment, as well as a host of commonplace and chance events that occur over their lifetime. And these operate to shape and influence the person's perceived perceptions of what's happening and what their options are. So within this framework, I've really built an approach where nurses reach out to patients between their acute care visits or clinic visits, and by phone, reach out and in a very individualized way, provide information, help to skills build, and provide effective support. And it's very individualized in this approach. So if a person is not having problems, they're adhering well, the conversation with the nurse may be very quick. But if they mention problems that they're having, why they weren't able to manage their medications or miss medications, the nurse works with them and tries to help them to develop problem-solving skills and support them in their adherence behavior. So this approach has been tested in several NIH studies now. In the first one, we found that the approach both improved both adherence behavior and viral outcomes. We repeated this in two studies with low-income participants and had the same findings. And I was at Yale before I came to Hopkins, and a colleague who was doing a postdoc there from India thought that this would have a really would be great for women in India, who a lot of them were having troubles getting to healthcare settings. And they thought by reaching out to them with the use of the phone and supporting them in their management of their HIV and adherence behavior, that could be very effective. And when I started going to India, it was a system that was characterized by very marked shortages of accessible healthcare that met even basic acceptable standards for HIV care and very limited emphasis on HIV prevention. And this picture here is very typical of what I'd often see in the clinics when I went around. Patients weren't given specific appointments, maybe a mass of people waiting. And so I didn't want to just take the intervention. My colleague was interested in testing it in India, but we thought we couldn't assume that the context would be the same. So we were able to get funding to do focus groups and individual interviews with women to find if this would be an acceptable approach to them and what they thought their priorities were, so we could help to prepare nurses who might be delivering the intervention. Around the same time, I was also invited to become a part of a project headed up by the Clinton Foundation. They had been very effective in helping to support the rollout of antiretrovirals in a number of countries in Africa. But when they came to rolling out antiretrovirals in India, they had a lot of difficulties because of the lack of adequate staff to really be able to provide management of the HIV. So the Clinton Foundation actually thought that it would be important to help train nurses to fill this gap. So as a part of a project to advance the education of nurses, and actually there was interest in building a whole institute to advance the education of nurses in their roles in India, and you can see here, I had a chance to meet Bill Clinton. And I really learned a lot through this project. This was a private-public partnership between the Clinton Foundation, a private sector donors, the government of India, and Yale University, with myself representing the educational component. And it really helped me to start to really appreciate the value of true partnerships in global work, of maximizing in-country resources, and on emphasis on long-term commitment and commitment to excellence and sustainability. And I think this is something we've seen in a lot of global work, that oftentimes it's very short. It will last 3 years and then it's over. And I think what I've learned from both my work as a researcher and in other initiatives is, you know, change takes time, takes perseverance. Other work I did of a similar nature was also HIV capacity building in Ghana, as my work started there. USAID had funded a project at Brown University, and they didn't have nursing representation to work in partnership with the University of Ghana to try to, again, prepare providers to be able to strengthen their HIV management. So I was able to go to Ghana and work with the School of Nursing there in enhancing, and also in the School of Medicine, and enhancing HIV, education around HIV management. And while I was there, I met several colleagues who we came to appreciate a big problem in HIV management of children in Ghana was that children didn't know of their diagnosis. And this has big ramifications for adherence behavior, especially among adolescents. Children, that sort of, if they don't know why they're ill, what's happening, they're less likely to be interested in taking their medications. So we conducted some focus groups to sort of learn more about this in Ghana. And we talked to the providers, and the providers sort of said, we think this is a family matter. The family should be telling the children. We talked to the families, and they said, they were worried the children were going to be angry at them if they were told, you know, it's going to be a lot of stigma for the family. They were worried the child was going to go off the deep end. And they said they just felt like they didn't have skills to be able to tell their child. So there we were at this sort of impasse, with the providers not seeing it as their role and the families not feeling confident about their ability to do this, and having a lot of questions about what the outcome would be. So really drawing from the work I had done with adherence, we developed an intervention that again used a very individualized approach. It was clinic-based, where we had the clinic select one provider who they thought could be become sort of the point person to discuss disclosure. And we used motivational interviewing techniques, where they learned those, and they would just, when the families would come to the clinic, the intervention was such that they would bring up the conversation with the family, sort of ask them if they had thought about telling their child about HIV, why not, and using this motivational interviewing approach, meet them over every time they came to the clinic. So there was no like six sessions and now you have to tell your child. It was, do you want to tell them, and we'll be there to help you support and we'll help you sort of think through. Well, this intervention was highly successful and in terms of the outcomes, and with many more of the families deciding to tell their child. And we also found that the children did not suffer adverse consequences. If anything, we saw that the children showed less depression after they were told they had HIV. So now I was very excited this summer to be funded to scale this study up in 12 different clinics. So the original trial was in two pretty ideal settings with probably the highest quality of HIV care. Now we're going to trial it in more commonplace clinics in India. And we're going to be using a pragmatic stack wedge cluster randomized trial in 12 real world HIV pediatric clinics in Ghana and look at the effectiveness, the health benefits, the cost, and obtain information to inform scale up and sustainability. So we'll really, this is really a implementation science approach where we want to be looking at not just whether or not it's effective in these clinics, but why or why not, and have this inform a potential scale up. And it's exciting that we have the Ministry of Health is represented on our team, as well as a community advisory board. I've also done quite a bit of work in China. And I originally got involved in working with the Central South University through my work with an NGO in New Haven, the Yale China Association. And I learned a lot from them, again, in terms of long-term commitment. They have had over 100-year relationship with the town of Changsha, which is in Central South China. And it's really been quite impressive to see through a number of different modalities how the capacity in this city has grown. And I've been very involved with the mentorship of faculty there, and I'm very proud to say that two of them have just been inducted into the American Academy of Nursing. But it's, you know, I've continued to work with them while I've been at Johns Hopkins, and it's been really impressive to see how just when I first started working with the School of Nursing there, they just really had one person prepared with a PhD, but they have since become the number one School of Nursing. And it's really through just coming to the US for 6 months studying here, they've become really a seed that has then really built the capacity in the School of Nursing. And I've just come to really see the value of these types of relationships. And now the capacity there is so strong that we're not really thinking about it, this as a capacity building partnership, but we're working in partnership together, planning other activities. And most recently, we've been really looking at rural China in Western Hunan and starting to think about how we could enhance a model of primary care there working together. So as Dean Davidson mentioned before, I was really delighted to have the opportunity to work on the State of the World's Nursing Report starting in 2019. And I served on the steering committee, and then JAPIGO was given the contract for helping to write the report and collect data for the report. So School of Nursing was also brought in, and so I was really helped with that aspect of the development of the report as well. And this report, if you haven't had a chance to see it yet, it makes a very compelling case for a radical change in the way the nursing workforce is educated, deployed, managed, and supported as a part of a broader health workforce and health system policies. And nursing really gets a lot of support from the current Director General of the WHO, Dr. Tedros, and I have this quote nursed from him: "Nurses play a critical role not only in delivering healthcare to millions around the world, but also in transforming health policies, promoting health in communities, and supporting patients and families. Nurses are central to achieving universal health coverage and the Sustainable Development Goals." And the report really essentially has three parts. And the first, it provides extant evidence of how the nursing workforce is already helping to deliver universal health coverage and the Sustainable Development Goals. And then it provides a very technical description of the nursing workforce in each of the member states, and then provides a number of recommendations and calling for much greater investment in the profession of nursing globally. The data in the report is the most extensive data that's ever been collected about nursing. And it's actually surprising how spotty the data is about nursing in many countries. And that was certainly surprising. But WHO has been promoting each member state putting data in these national health workforce accounts, and nursing sort of led the way on this. So many countries that had not collected data collected it as we went along, and we're putting it into these national health workforce accounts. And we're certainly hoping that this is going to provide stronger data about nursing going forward. But information was provided on several key indicators by the 191 WHO member states. And I'll just share with you a few of the common findings. These are sort of summary comments made about nursing globally. But I will say, if you go to the website of WHO, there's a summary for each country individually, because obviously there's a great variety of across different countries. So the density of nursing, we found that there are roughly 27.9 million nurses globally, about 19 million of them are professional nurses. It's really estimated that we had a minimum of around a 6 million gap needed in the number of nurses. And of course, not surprisingly, this gap is greatest in lower and middle income countries. Nursing workforce is largely female and relatively young. And being a highly gendered profession as it is, it's been associated with many biases in the workplace. The average years of education are 3. And I see Dean Davidson here. I think we were really edging, wanting to make some recommendations about standardizing what should be the basic number of years of entry into nursing. And I think we're getting closer to that. We were at least able to include Linda Aiken's work, which showed that bachelor's level nurses make a difference in terms of health outcomes and ultimately cost. A total of about 53% of the countries that provided us response reported having an advanced practice roles for nurses. And these tended to be higher in the countries that had fewer physicians. And then most countries had some sort of legal protections in place, but it was not equitable across the regions. And certainly many nurses are at risk from exposures to infectious diseases, poor working conditions, and many times in many countries, even threats to their physical safety. So the key takeaway from the report is we need a greater investment in the nursing profession. But what now? You know, how do we act on this report? How do we have this be more than just a report that sits in people's files? How do we raise the voice and the important contributions of nurses and act on the recommendations of this report? How do we take this evidence and put it into action? And Lord Nigel Crisp is the co-chair of the Nursing Now. And he's been a huge proponent of nurses. And he's a very regarded global health expert. And he says the biggest thing we can do for health globally is to strengthen nursing. And he says, this is the year of the nurse and the midwife, and not one that any of us had envisioned, but the COVID-19 outbreak is the most powerful demonstration of why we need support and to invest in our nursing workforce. And he says, it will be the greatest tragedy if we do not learn from the lessons of this pandemic. And the State of the World's Nursing Report, along with several other reports that have come out, really say that investment in nursing at minimum is going to help improve health outcomes, as well as the economies in countries. And of course, it will help with gender equity. And key areas for investment, first of all, leadership. And at a minimum, it's really thought that each country needs a chief nursing officer. And we really need leadership development and opportunities at all levels, local, regionally, nationally, and globally. And it's really about being a part of shared decision-making and policy-making. And Elizabeth Arrow, the CNO of the WHO, she says, nurses and midwives are already leaders in delivering care. The next step is to put them at the heart of policy making. Education, as I mentioned before, we need 6 million more nurses around the globe. So there really is a need for increased funding to educate more nurses for the workforce. And we really need educational programs that prepare nurses for the future and drive progress in primary health care and universal health coverage. And certainly there's a large role for more advanced practice preparation. Practice, there are a lot of implications about the ethical management for nurse migration and improved retention. Part of the problem with the shortage in many of the lower middle income countries that nurses go to higher settings where they get greater pay. And a certain amount of this is to be expected, but there's actually been some unethical ways that this gets handled. So we really recommendation for more thinking around this issue. Also, it's important to think about optimizing the contributions of nursing so they can work their full scope of practice. And this is certainly what I found in my work in India. With here, I was working with the Clinton Foundation and the government, how difficult it was there to change the role of nursing. And even though we had this wonderful partnership with all these key intersectoral players, it was still very difficult to make an argument for expanding the scope or having nurses practice to their full scope there. And of course, we need better working conditions and attention to the mental health. We're seeing this acutely with COVID, what nurses are suffering from, and we can expect to have long-term ramifications. And lastly, something that may not be emphasized in the report as much as I would like to see it is I think, you know, research is incredibly important. Research and data are critical to empowering our frontline nurses to really take their place at the heart of the 21st century health challenges. You know, we need scientifically informed healthcare practice, evidence-based practice. We need data for the delivery of quality care and for quality improvement. We need evidence that supports the role in the impact of nurses and midwives. You know, the State of the World's Nursing Report is a step in that direction, but we need more data. And we need to inform educational programming and health policy that affect frontline workers. And we need, you know, nurse preparation of nurses as scientists, you know, as equal leaders in knowledge development. Unfortunately, while these are critical, there really is a lack of emphasis on the preparation of nurse scientists, you know, especially in lower and middle income countries. There's just a lack of preparation for nurse-led research, nurse scientist education, and the education of nurse clinicians who are comfortable translating research to practice and generating research questions and using data to inform policy. I think it's critically important that we develop or support more the development of more high quality nursing doctoral programs that meet university and international cross-disciplinary standards of excellence. We need mentoring of faculty in schools. And this is where I feel in the State of the World's Nursing Report. It's there, but I don't think we emphasize enough, I think, the importance of building the capacity of faculty as scientists and as users of science. And we need clinical coursework that's taught from an evidence-based framework and increased funding for research. The Fogarty support some, but very little so far in nursing, and really leadership that prioritizes research and data-driven strategies. So I just want to say, you know, I think nursing has such amazing global potential. You know, we are the largest group of health professionals in the world. We're experts in chronic illness management and self-care behavior and care of vulnerable, underserved populations. We bring an integrated biopsychosocial perspective. Our values are person-centered and humanitarian, which is what we need right now. I was just reading on social media, what's needed now in global health is awareness, empathy, and action. Nurses are so well suited for this and in the delivery of primary health care, which is sorely needed around the world. And I'll just conclude by saying nurses have a central role to play in addressing the health challenges of the 21st century. The COVID pandemic is highlighting the serious deficiencies in health systems and the critical importance of nurses as well as vulnerabilities. Nurses are critical to strong healthcare systems as frontline workers, leaders, researchers, innovators, transformers of health policies. Greater investment in nursing is needed throughout the world. And if ever there was a time to invest in nursing, it's now. And I will just leave with this quote. If you have heard me talk before, I often use it because it's something I really take with me a lot in my work. Locally and globally. And this was a quote from Robert Kennedy, a comment that he made in 1966. And you realize that was sort of the insight he had. You know, everywhere new technology and communications brings men, and I'll say people and nations closer together, and the concerns of one inevitably become the concerns of all. And each time a person stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others, or strikes out against injustice, they send forth a tiny ripple of hope in crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring those ripples to build a current. So I'll stop there and thank you very much for your attention.
So thanks so much, Dr. Reynolds. And normally we would hear resounding applause, and thanks for giving us some hope at a time of anguish for many. Rafe, if you could unmute the microphones, please. And I'd invite people in our remaining 10 minutes to ask any questions or make any comments. And maybe while people are waiting, it's been great to see Dr. Reynolds. We have junior faculty and students who are particularly doctoral students who are listening in today. And so, you know, in the vision of Isabel Hampton Robb, you know, I'm sure it was not easy for her to make change. And you've had a very successful career breaking boundaries. I was just wondering if you would want to maybe give a couple of tips for our more junior colleagues.
Sure. You know, I think this was a comment that was made by at the Academy recently, but I've always been, you know, a huge, when I work with doctoral students, I often will say, you know, passion is key to care, to do something that you care about, because I do think in my career with research that it takes perseverance. And I think for me, it comes from a sense of passion and urgency and commitment to the problem. And I really see that in my global health work too. It's sort of being there for the long run and really investing in it and advocating and doing what you have to do. And I always have tried to work from a very interdisciplinary perspective, and sometimes, actually often, I've been the only nurse on the teams that I work with. But I think doing good work is essential and challenging yourself. I know in doctoral programs, sometimes people have looked for ways just to get through them with the most ease, but I think it's a great time to build a foundation which the rest of one's career gets built on. And I think reaching out, I just, you know, and this is nothing new to anyone probably on this call, but I just increasingly appreciated the importance of mentorship at all stages of one's career. And I see this so much in my global work too. And I see at other universities, schools of nursing reaching out to us, reaching out to Hopkins for support in mentorship of nurse scientists and nurse practitioners. And I think Hopkins has so much to offer. And I will say that faculty have given very generously of their time to our visiting scholars program, which unfortunately is not as active as it normally is. We only have one scholar here right now. We usually have many, and I'm hoping once we are back being able to be back face to face that we'll be able to bring more scholars. But I can't tell you the impact that it has for developing scholars' careers when they come to Hopkins and spend 3 months, 6 months, or a year working with faculty and having mentorship.
Thanks so much. Dr. Dion has asked, you know, in the context of COVID-19, you know, what is your take on what's going to happen in the global health sector? You already mentioned an interruption to traveling, but you know, what's COVID-19 going to mean for global health?
Well, it's interesting, you know, so I put that quote up of Robert Kennedy, who was appreciating how our boundaries were not what they were, and yet it seemingly countries are trying to impose this sense of boundaries that, you know, health does, and we're seeing with this virus, it does not know boundaries. If anything, you know, we need to be working more closely together right now. I think an interesting thing has really been the digital space, and how I think it has a lot of potential for global health work going forward. And I look at the work, Dean Davidson, that you've done in developing a course on Future Learn and how it's had thousands of practitioners and faculty sign up for this course to learn about the management of COVID. And I think that maybe we need to be thinking more. If anything, I think it's bringing more of an equalizing factor, because a lot of times our work was dependent on needing able to go to a meeting, and not all schools of nursing faculty have the money to be able to go to meetings. So now I think there's a lot of opportunity for interface in the digital space, and it may be better for our planetary health as well.
Thanks so much. Dr. Commodore Mensa has asked, you know, reflecting on your experiences in Ghana and China, what tips could you provide for doing research in low and middle income countries?
Well, you know, I think about a colleague of mine, a comment that he made when we were getting to near the end of our study there. And he just sort of sighed and he said, well, research studies, they come and go. And sort of, I have low expectations for what's going to happen from this in the long run. And fortunately, with perseverance on our part, we've just had this new grant funded, and we're really hoping that this is going to lead to longer term impact in the country. But again, I see partnerships as so important, and not if you're US-based, necessarily going into a country and sort of, and one of the things that's actually really concerned me in my global health work is oftentimes universities from a lower middle income country reach out to the US for advice. And many times we are exporting a model that has a lot of problems, as I was mentioning with our acute care model, is not necessarily the most effective model in the way we finance. So I think we really, and in all of my work, it's been characterized by really understanding the context and so much listening and having the partners provide leadership in the direction that the work goes. And in all of my funded studies, I've always had a partner or co-PI who is of the culture that we are working in. And I don't know if that answers your question, but that's certainly one thing that immediately comes to mind. And again, this a commitment and, you know, respect for culture.
So thanks so much, Nancy. I'm building upon that and some of the other questions Dr. Gurwan has asked about, you know, what can we do as a community to advance a global health agenda more broadly? I think you've mentioned some of the activities, our visiting scholars program, digital activities, engagement in the WHO collaborating centers. But at this critical juncture in history where there is moves to nationalism and populism, how do we use really the power of our brand and reputation for good in this sector?
Yeah, well, you know, I do think Hopkins is already doing a lot. You know, I think we are a model, and that goes a long way. And I do see our faculty as being very generous and with their time and all of that. I do think that advocacy is incredibly important. And I think, Dean Davidson, you are an amazing model of that and something that many of us aspire to. And we actually, our PhD program, we had an external review this year. The advice we received from the external reviewers was, well, Hopkins, you know, you're such a leader. You should be a leader in global PhD education. And I think this is something that we can all think about more, how we can even enhance our role as global leaders, but working with faculty and students in other countries. And we certainly have a platform to do that now. As Secretariat of the WHO Collaborating Centers, we're immediately put, we have this vast network of 44 different collaborating centers all around the world. Plus, we have memorandums of understanding with some 30 universities and ministries of health. And now, you know, Dean Davidson has worked with the Consortium of Universities of Global Health. I've gotten very engaged with their workforce committee, and this is another vast network. They have 30,000. So we really have a network there where I think we could work to really support nursing in the development. And I think as, you know, Research One institution, we have a large role to play in the development of doctorally prepared faculty who can develop and use evidence. Because that, I think, is really the critical thinking that goes with that, the ability to inform policy, it's incredibly important.
Well, thanks so much, Dr. Reynolds, for a wonderful presentation. Your exceptional work and leadership is certainly inspiring to us all, and I'm sure Isabel Hampton-Robb will be very proud. I wanted to thank everybody for joining us today. It's great to be together, albeit virtually. Thank you again to Dr. Reynolds. Please be safe and well, everyone. And if people have the stamina, tonight at 6 o'clock, we have a Facebook Live session where we really want to increase the spotlight on really the tragedy of children being separated from their families. And we'll have Dr. Alvarez, Dr. Glass, Dr. Spiegel, and Dr. Lawton from University of Virginia. So please use our voice. This is a real issue at the moment that we really all want to be able to keep the spotlight on. So thanks again, Dr. Reynolds, for an exceptional presentation. Be safe and well, everyone. And thank you again to Rafe and Matt for a seamless presentation. So thanks, everybody. Be well.